First thing I need to make absolutely clear is that the material that I am discussing tonight is extremely powerful, extremely intense. It's possible that maybe not amongst us here, but people that might end up watching this on the internet somewhere in the future could get a little bit triggered, a little bit upset. I'm putting that warning in right from the word go. Now you may well say, you know, look Paul, this is the Positive Living Group. You know, what are you going to do to us here? We want something nice to go home with. We don't want our heads smashed. Well, stick with me, because this story ultimately, I'd like to think, contains indications of tremendous transformative power of work in the world. And the reason, you know, one of the many reasons that I want to share it is because I'm convinced from talking to people over the years, especially here in Glastonbury, that a lot of people are going through their own very distinctly strange, unusual, disturbing experiences, and they need some maps for territory. They need to know that they are not alone in this and that some sense can be made of it. So Kundalini then. Kundalini is one of those words that I'm sure everybody in here has heard and has some knowledge of. In the esoteric yogic systems, it is a term that defines the life force. And it is usually symbolized by a serpent. Because many of the experiences of this force in motion are of undulating waves that work their way through the body. And we've got a kind of established modern mythology of what this is and how it works. We've got supposedly seven chakra systems, subtle zones within our internal anatomy, and this serpent force, when awakened by whatever means, yogic or otherwise, works its way up through them until it blasts its way out of the top of your head, and everything is pretty damn good at that point. But the thing is, as is becoming clear by Roy's scholarship, it's almost arbitrary that we found ourselves buying into this definitive form of seven chakras. There are loads of other systems of thought in India and the tantric scriptures that will tell you there's different numbers of chakras. All we need to know is basically the idea that there is some kind of primal life energy force that is not fully active in most individuals that can become active. And we hear stories of people that have just spontaneously awoken this force. And probably the most well-known story is that of Gopi Krishna, who really went through some serious stuff and became in the process some kind of prodigy, you know, was able to suddenly write in languages that he previously didn't know, but went through a lot of physiological torment. I think I can recall stories of his toenails turning black and dropping off, all this kind of thing. And you hear stories of people who are going through Kundalini awakenings and they're spending just hours in the shower with the cold shower full on because they're just burning up. When you look more broadly into this subject, you see that although we generally tend to think of this as something that is an active, a force that is based at the bottom of our spinal columns and rises up, that the activation of it is something that usually occurs through some kind of guru or teacher, and they allow that force to enter in the top of the head. It comes in from the top and works its way down, and at a certain point where it hits, then everything starts moving and working its way up. And I became fascinated a long time ago, you know, way back in the 80s, with what's all this business about gurus awakening Kundalini. And at the time, the most well-known, notorious, charismatic guru on the planet was Bhagwan Sri Rajneesh, who's now best known as Osho. And in his ashram in Pune, all kinds of stuff was going down. It was an amazing scene, one way or another, whatever in retrospect we might now make of it. And I was really intrigued by the charisma that was reported of this man. There was one particular account by an elderly American guy. He had actually been present in the 1930s, I think it was 1938, at one of the Nuremberg rallies. He'd seen Hitler quite up close, and he'd registered that there was voltage coming out of him that was above and beyond the norm. You couldn't just put it down to the whole scenario of, well, okay, he's got 500,000 people in front of him going gaga for anything he says. Of course there's a bit of an atmosphere. He registered that there was something a bit more than that going on. Later on in his life, he'd actually been present right up close to President Kennedy, seeing him give him one of his famous speeches, and again registered that there was just this incredible, indefinable charisma, this power coming out of him that defied rational analysis. Now this guy met Osho when he was still in Bombay in 1970. So this is before the Pune Ashram is founded, before he gets really famous. He's just starting to gather people around himself and initiate them into sannyas, as they called it. And he said that the voltage that was coming out of Osho completely blew Kennedy and Hitler away. But just sitting about 20 feet away from him, he didn't even have to say a word. People were just swooning, people were going into these altered states of consciousness. And I just thought, what the hell is that? What is it? I want some of that. You know, I'm a young guy in his early 20s. I'm smoking loads of dope. I'm doing loads of acid. So I have the kind of terminology and the attitude of it's like getting a big hit from some drugs. Now, all right, I know that's the wrong attitude to cultivate, but you might be led to something worthwhile for starting that way. And over the years, I've made a point of reading accounts of people that have been in the vicinity of these gurus, these characters that are generating this voltage. And one of those shows, Sannyas, is Master Chabati. She wrote a couple of books, Death Comes Dancing and The Ultimate Risk, on what it was like to actually be in Pune in those days. And yeah, you know, people that were just sleeping outside Osho's bedroom were kind of going into trance-like states and having visions of past lives. People, you know, flopping about, having all these kind of weird, undulating, life force spasms going through them. And you may well have seen photos or film footage where Osho is initiating people into becoming his devotees, if you like, what's called sannyas, and he's touching them on their forehead, you know, their eyes rolling up in their head, they're flopping about, they're in a state of bliss. And it's not just that in itself, it's what happens afterwards. Because their whole personal process is accelerated to the max. Whatever weird stuff you've got going on, whatever stuff you haven't dealt with, whatever things need to come up, it's accelerated into a form that is almost absurd. It's almost a comedy. And what really attracted me about Rajneesh at the time was the fact that within the Pune Ashram, you had a whole bunch of cutting-edge Western therapies, you know, encounter groups and so on, stuff that had come straight from the Soul and Institute. And at the same time, it was, or so everyone believed, being intensified and accelerated by the power of the Shakti Kundalini force, the Shakti Pat initiatory force that was constantly emanating from it, that this was a Buddha zone, that if you were in the vicinity of one of these kind of characters and all of this infrastructure was in place, and you're a bunch of people committed to personal transformation, incredible things could happen. Well, we now know, you know, in retrospect, certainly when the whole thing went stateside, that something went terribly, terribly wrong. And in the end, Master Chabali wrote a third book, The Promise of Paradise, which is all about a disillusionment with what happened in America. Where, as you probably know, you know, Osho Sannyas built a whole city out there, the whole thing went wrong. I know people that were there. Some of them will say it was paradise, some of them will say it was like a goddamn prison camp. Yeah, the main thing is I took this abiding interest in, regardless of the rights and wrongs, regardless of all the blah 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 about, look, he's got 93 Rolls Royces, what is all this about? I just zeroed in on what to me was the core of what he seemed to be saying, which was very non-dual, very Advaita Vedanta, very formless, very much in terms of what many of us would now heard from many other teachers, the whole quest, the whole form of the quest is just a distraction. You already are the thing that you are trying to become. Just get out of your own way, abide in the now, and it will all happen. And in the presence of such a character as him, the stuff that is in the way gets burned to a cinder. So, you know, I was at university in the early 80s. I absorbed loads of this stuff, absolutely loads of it. I think I had a collection of about 30, 40 of Osho's books. I just read through all this stuff. And I also was very conscious that he created these meditations that were not just passive, where you're just sitting there, but they were active. Things where you're, you know, jumping up, down and shaking for 15 minutes, dancing for 15 minutes, getting all the physical tension out, and then you settle into stillness. And if you do that, the mind is not going to give you all of the nonsense. So fast forward to the summer of 1992, and I'm living in Southend, and there's a new age shop there called Dimensions, and they've got some bit of room in the back, and one of the people in there well, called by a sannyas name, which eventually took Dana. She started organising some evenings of the Osho meditations. And, you know, I used to go in there and do Kundalini meditation, do Nataraj meditation, which is like 40 minutes of dancing around. And got into quite an interesting, you know, dynamic with Dana. You know, there was a whole bunch of stuff going on where she was interested in all this Eastern stuff. She was doing a psychotherapy course that was supervised by some people that had been out with Osho and were pretty intense. She was also, you know, a natural psychic, very, very, very visionary, going through what you might call a spontaneous initiation as a priestess. Where that ultimately leads, because there's so many people that go through a similar thing, at the end of the day now, after getting involved, working with the Rape Crisis Centre, going around the world, talking to gatherings at the United Nations HQ and also the EU HQ in Brussels, you know, she ended up getting an OBE for her work. So she's somebody grounded who also went through a tremendous amount of stuff, and in 1992, you know, as part of my story as well. And it was whilst doing that Raj in the back of this shop that I fell over and really smashed my ankle in something badly. And this became my introduction to Reiki, because they also used to have Reiki initiations in the back of the shop. They'd shut the whole thing off for the weekend and create this zone with all these crystals and all the rest of it. Now, this is 1992, you know, no one's really doing Reiki then. These days, I don't know how many Reiki masters there are in Glastonbury. There's probably about half a dozen in practically every street. But in those days, there wasn't an awful lot of it about. I'd never even heard of it. And, you know, one day they said to me, come in the back of the shop, and we've set up this little zone where the attunements are going to happen, see if you can feel anything in here. So I walked in there, and it's like, at that point, I was not a crystals, Reiki kind of guy. I walked into the corner where they set up this little area where people were going to sit and have their Reiki attunements. And I could feel this, whoa, going all over me. And I thought, yeah, I can feel something here. What is this? This is very, very interesting. So after I spanked my ankle in, you know, yeah, okay, I'll have a bit of Reiki on my ankle, please. Let's see what happens here. And, you know, Dana puts her hands on my ankle, and I can immediately feel all this heat working its way through my body, and I can feel like it's like lemonade bubbles kind of going up my legs. I'm thinking, hang on, this is actually something that's real here. This is pretty funky. I like this. And she kind of said to me, well, you know, one day you ought to do the first degree Reiki. And I said, well, maybe. So we came down to Glastonbury a couple of times. Always remember seeing Osric Tentacles out in a field at Monstro. That was a hell of a day, that was. But when we were in town, we noticed some adverts up. There was a guy calling himself Manan, and he was advertising something called Osho Divine Energy Dolls, which was about like ETs and dolphins and stuff. What the hell's that? What's this? You know, and we also found out that he was doing B&B. So it got to round about the time of the old Mechronox, and thought, let's come down and let's stay with this nutcase and see what the hell he's freaking doing. Chatting dolphins, because it didn't seem like the kind of stuff that was connected with Osho. Osho, as I say, was ultimately very Upanishads, very Advaita Vedanta, very formless. And all this stuff, all this form, all this gubbins, dolphin channeling, what, you know. And it wasn't like we were going to go down there to take the piss out of me, give them bad time. It was just an interesting anthropological study. If you're going to come down to Glastonbury, you might as well, you know, have an interesting weekend's entertainment. And I'd already got, you know, dolphin channeling high on my list of nutter stuff. Back in the days when I was in Andy Connick's Earth Quest group in Essex, you know, our Christmas parties used to be a bit full on, and we liked to put something on for people to entertain them. And I'd seen a documentary that I'd videoed about LA psychics, and there were some dolphin channelers on it, you know, and there were these people going, you know, going at funny voices and talking as if they were dolphins. and I videoed it, and I showed it to Andy. We just played it over and over and over again. So I introduced Andy Collins channeling dolphins at the first Christmas party, and I think it was 1990. So that was my sense of it. So we went down there and, you know, met up with this guy, and I'll tell you where he lived, because if you live in Glastonbury, you'll be able to register this. Where the old Maitreya Centre is, where Buddha Ron is, right above that, there's a bunch of flats there, and you can just see a little kind of attic skylight there. Down in that flat, that's where the man was at the time. So we meet him, we go in there, you know, he just looks like an Osho sannyasin, I guess. In those days, it was beards, it was slightly long hair. Seems like a nice chap. We all sit down in his living room, and we've only been there about half an hour, just had a little chat where he just says, I think something wants to happen now. If we can just close our eyes. Now, my man, ultimately, I learned this over a period of years in the air, was a guy who spent an awful lot of his life with his eyes closed and his hands up in the air, sort of directing the traffic, giving it all of this. And he starts doing this, and we're sort of invited to just relax. So I'm sitting in his chair and I relax. And I start to realise it sort of feels like my legs are sort of blending together. And then it feels like my eyes are starting to move around the side of my head. And then I realise that it's like I've got this huge, great grin that is like way wider than my mouth should be. And then I think, oh, fucking hell, I'm turning into a dolphin. In Glastonbury, all places, it's finally happened. And there was a little part of my mind that was resisting this. And you know, after about 5 or 10 minutes, I'm trying to just kind of pull myself back out of it. And I kind of opened my eyes, but no, I've done what I have. I'm out again. And it's like about half an hour's worth of this. And when we finally come out of it, you know, I've turned into a dolphin. Dana has shown the entire ceiling has dissolved into outer space, right? Like a little mini Spielberg mothership has come down into the room, and all these little ETs looking like skinned frogs, as she put it, start coming out and hopping about all over the place. And dolphins have swum through the walls and have swum across the room and out the other side. And it's like, all right, mate, you got us. Right. What's going on here? We'll have some more of this. So, you know, this was Friday night. We spent a whole weekend with this guy, just in these kind of spaces, and it was a real revelation. You know, with all, you know, all the occult malarkey that I've been involved with, all the psychic quest and all the rest of it, I had never been in a space like that before. That was really something. So this incredible light, you know, this incredible explosive, ecstatic energy has kind of made itself very much known to me. What my name could be, divine energy dance. He said that he'd spoken to Osho, he'd had a one-to-one with Osho, and he had said, look, you know, what is this stuff? Because, you know, you don't normally encourage this, it's a distraction. What am I supposed to do about this? And Osho had actually said to him, in your case, you must go with this as far as it will take you. So he had basically taken that as his cue to just, you know, do this forever. And I get back to Southend, and something kind of happens that becomes very emblematic of the whole process of opening up. I was living in a block of terraced houses that, in the manner of modern times, upstairs and downstairs have been separated into different flats. But nobody's taking into account soundproofing or anything like that. So if you have the neighbour from hell downstairs, then it's going to get a little bit difficult. And I did have the neighbour from hell downstairs. You know, I had this guy and his girlfriend. It's funny, I knew when I first moved in, I knew that she had dyed blonde hair and wore a miniskirt. at least 2 weeks before I ever saw her. I could just tell that from hearing her voice shouting from downstairs. And this guy was a right chancer. His thing was, he actually had an amplified bass guitar, you know, in this terraced house. And he didn't play it that much, but what he kind of had this signature of the riff of Cream's Sunshine You'll Love. And what used to happen is, he'd go out to a nightclub and I'd hear him come in at 1 o'clock in the morning, and then you'd hear this distinctive sound of the amp getting switched on and this buzzing sound, and I knew what was coming. I was kind of immediately like this in my head. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. The whole house shook, and that was it, that's all he did. Then he went to bed. So this was kind of grand, this is my normal, but I get back from having turned into a dolphin, and he's got a whole bunch of guys back there in his flat, they're all playing guitars, and they're singing all these songs, and it's really flipping loud, and I've got to go to work tomorrow. And you can't let these people get one over on you, because if you let people get away with this kind of shit, then you have had it. So, you know, I'm in Essex, by the way, you know, so this amplifies the whole thing. So it is actually a measure of having been in Essex that I did have a pair of knuckle dusters. And in fact, I ended up sleeping with a pair of knuckle dusters under my pillow for 3 years as a result of you know, the people that I had living downstairs from me. I switch into a cultist mode. I do the lesser banishing ritual, the pentagram, in my living room. I extend that even further into the lesser banishing ritual with a hexagram. You know, I'm really going for it. And I put these knuckle dusters on, I'll go downstairs and I'll punch the geezer's front door and just scream at him, "Shut the fuck up!" Now, at this point, I don't know how many people he's got in there. I don't know what's going to happen. You know, a whole bunch of drunken morons could have just piled out of there and kicked the shit out of me. It was an edgy situation, but I had to do something about it. So I've actually left a dent in his front door, and they do shut. And at this point, you know, it's broadly been handled. But I registered the incredible dichotomy between where I've been at turning into a dolphin and this shit, you know. Now, just as a little sort of follow-on from, you know, dolphin channelers, like what to expect from the man, you know, he was an extraordinary guy. Some of the stuff that he did dolphin massages, right? Dolphin massages. And what that consisted of was him putting his hands together like this, so they're like little flippers. And stand up. He's just standing over you, and he's just doing that, making dolphin noises. Which, of course, is completely bleeding ridiculous. But I knew people had dolphin massages off him, and I spaced the shit out of them. So they were off the planet with this stuff. So what the hell? And in late years when I moved here, I haven't seen Manan since 1997, but he was around in Glastonbury in 1996 quite a bit. I saw quite a lot of him, and he was a difficult guy to have, kind of, you know, one of my girlfriend at the time, he pretty much lived around her flat. And he would wake up, you know, and he'd have a little pain in his big toe. But, you know, nothing simple for a guy like this. He's got to be so seriously esoteric about it, so he's got you know, pendulum crystal thing. I saw this happen, you know. He just sits there with his eyes closed, and he's kind of doing this crystal over his big toe. And he said, he opened his eyes and says, "Extraterrestrial sexual abuse in Atlantis." So then he gets the Glastonbury Oracle, and he looks for all the practitioners, and he's again, who is he going to go and have a session with to sort this out? And he goes off and, you know, goes to Bridget Centre or whatever and comes back. "You all right?" "Yeah, I'm okay, yeah." So, dolphin challenge, you know, what can you do with them? So, at this point, my whole sense of Osho is really peaked. And I decided that I wanted, you know, and all the time he'd been alive, because he died in 1990, I'd never taken sannyas, and I thought, well, me and Donna decided we're going to do it. as ever, why assign now to him, whatever the case, let it be registered in the Akashic records that we've dug in. So this involves sending a letter out to Pune, okay, and then whatever the hell happens, they choose a sannyas name for you, and then you get a letter back. Obviously, it's all the way out in India. When you get it back, who knows when that's going to be. But Manana said he was going to be around for a few months before he was going back to India. If we got the nod from Pune that we were now officially sannyasins, he could do an energy attunement, he could actually do a sannyas initiation. He considered himself empowered to do that, and I thought, yeah, okay, I'll go for that. That sounds brilliant. Same sort of time, I now walked talk about the autumn of 1992. As a result of going Dana and her shop, a woman comes on our radar called Sandra. And she was a pretty strange one for sure. She was pretty interesting. She was in the nature. There's not that many women in the nature, actually. That should have been a little indicator. She told all these kind of stories, like she was engaged to be married to some Sulu prince, and how she was a witch, and she was in Bikavi, and how she was psychic, and all the rest of it. And she was quite interesting, and, Donna brought her around my flat, and there were some things in my flat that were kind of hangovers from my days of psychic questing, things that had a bit of a cold voltage. Without going into the stories too much, I had a candle that had been part of a little ritual that we'd done by the sea in Cornwall to bring the Gorgons out of the sea. I can't even remember what the bloke we did that, but anyway, there had also been talk, there had been a whole thing that there was a portal to ancient Egypt and the step pyramid of Saqqara in my bedroom, That's a whole story in itself, but she kind of came in. She didn't know nothing about this, I hadn't said anything about this, and she said, "What is it with that candle over there? I'm really drawn to that candle over there." And then she'd say, why am I picking up on the step pyramid of Saqqara here?" So it was like whatever the darkest, weirdest shit that was in my living room, she just tuned straight into it. So I thought, hello. We decided to keep her at arm's length. She wanted to keep one of them, turn up on a few of our little outings, and we kept her at arm's length. And as the story progresses, you'll see that that was probably a pretty wise decision, as it turned out. So I've been talked into doing some Reiki initiations now. There was going to be a first degree Reiki initiation spread out over a whole weekend, four attunements, starting off on a Friday night. And I didn't really know what I was letting myself in for. I found out in retrospect, you have this story about Reiki that it's come from a Japanese source, Mikawa Sui, and that the lineage of it works its way through Japan and then crosses over the Pacific with a white car in Hawaii, then introduces it to lots of Americans. And it's a thing in itself. It's absolutely kind of self-contained in it, or at least this is how it was presented to me at the time, and it's got no connection with anybody else. But it turns out that the woman that initiated me into Reiki, one of them called Martha Sylvester, she had come into contact with Reiki at the ashram of Swami Muktananda. There are a bunch of early Reiki masters that were all practicing and putting it out in Muktananda's ashram, Ganjpuri in India. Now, Muktananda was another one of these heavy hitters, another one of these Kundalini superstars. And he's the kind of guy that can just whack a whole room full of people out with the sheer energy, the sheer voltage of what he was carrying, to the extent that people are literally just flopping about on the floor, barking like dogs. It's like something out of The Exorcist. People's heads are practically turning around 360 degrees. They're really going for it. In the classic Kundalini manifestations, you're suddenly able to assume really difficult, complex yoga poses that you had not previously been able to do. You suddenly just snap into it. He could do this. And he went on a stadium tour in America with Ram Dass in the 70s, and huge amounts of people were blasted to smithereens by him. And the account of his initiation by his guru, Swami Nityananda, in Monks and Osho's autobiography, Player Consciousness, is probably the greatest account of the transmission of Kundalini force from one to another and the sheer havoc that that wreaked in his life. Extant anywhere in any of the scriptures, it's an absolute must read. And what I discovered, I later heard a long time afterwards, because all kinds of things started happening to me. This is almost a side angle on the main story here that seems to be not a million miles away from things that had happened to Mutananda in relation to Shiva and a so-called vision of the blue pearl. I later heard that Martha Sylvester had one of those situations, the devotees are literally sleeping outside the guru's bedroom because they get blasted to bits just by sleeping, outside his front door. They're in a visionary state that cannot be ascertained as am I awake, am I asleep, what's going on. She saw Muktananda towering over her and he pointed to her and he said, "You will bring your people to me." And it kind of felt that if you got a little bit of preparation, you had a certain temperament, a certain aspect, who knows what the qualifications for this kind of gig are, but me and Dana seemed to get a bit of Muktananda in on the choir, as well as Reiki 1. So that was enough to be going on with. The very next weekend I was due to come down to Glastonbury for what was Manan's final divine energy dance group before he went to India. And the day before that was supposed to happen, I got the letter from India saying that I'd been initiated into sannyas. So that meant that when I got there, he'd go for it. So Dana had got her letter as well. So we have a weekend of dolphins and blah, blah, blah. And then on the Saturday night, at the end of it all, he goes for it with me. Now, if you've read my Avalone Neon, you'll know that earlier on that year, I'd done a rebirthing, a Leonard Hall rebirthing, on my 33rd birthday, first time I'd ever done anything like that. And I was very fortunate that, I just didn't have any fear or any resistance to it or what the hell happened to me in a public setting. So I just screamed my brains out and cried my eyes out and flopped about and had an absolutely awesome time of it. And really did rate the whole process very highly. And I think because I've done that, because I hadn't got any resistance, because I hadn't got any fear of anything really in that situation, I was completely and utterly open to whatever the hell Manan was doing while he had his hand on my forehead. Now bear in mind, I'm just in a flat in Glastonbury High Street. I started literally just screaming my freaking brains out at the top of my head. I felt like my entire rib cage was just going to burst open. And Dana later told me that she could see this enormous serpent working its way up my spine while all this was going on. And to be honest, I'm amazed nobody called the police or an ambulance or anything. It must have been out of earing, flipping half a mile away. It was 20 minutes I was doing this. And there were some other people that were part of the Divine Energy Dance group had stayed behind to see this because they knew what was going to happen, and they were crying. It was pretty flipping full on, man, it was. And at the end of it all, what I could say I felt like, the nearest thing to it is like coming up on some acid, maybe for people that are familiar with LSD, it was like an incredible level of clarity that was virtually, it was trembling on the verge of hallucination. In other words, if you as we were going away in a car at the end of it, the halos around the lampposts were like quadruple the size I would normally be. Everything was high definition. It was like going, from a DVD up to a Blu-ray. It was pretty extraordinary. So that's kind of it in itself, but what follows on? What then happens as a result of that? Dana had got a bit of a background drinking in the past. She literally, I'm at the top of my tree and I just want to sit and read Osho and listen to some spacey music. She got home to her place, I think, and just down the bottom of the martini. And this began, a couple of months in the Twilight Zone as an indicator of how that works. You know, there was a guy, previous boyfriend of hers, she split up with him, she'd had to sling him out because he had set fire to her flat because he thought it was full of snakes. So, you get rid of a guy like that. But he came back and she was just powerless to resist it. And it all got a little bit flipping difficult, And there was an incredible New Year's Eve. There was an Osho celebration up in London, and I went up there with her, and this guy was there with her, and it was like really terrible, and I wanted to be with her, and he was like completely overpowering her, and he was like, I didn't like him at all. And we're in the car on the way home, and he starts complaining about all these bloody packages there. So I just punched him in the head, I was in the back seat, and he's in the front seat giving out all this verbal. Could have caused a car crash, I just punched him in the head. And when we finally pull up in Southend, he's got to get out, and then I've got to get out. And it's like, we're facing it down and giving it all the blah, 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 and he could quite easily have ended up in a fight in the street, but he didn't. But where that got me to, you do Reiki one of the things that you're supposed to do. Is like you put your hands on your body and each night you do 20 minutes of self-reiki and it's all purified, it's all brilliant, it's all funky. I'm doing this for like weeks and all I can think of is beating the fucking shit out of this geezer. It's like every single night I'm just going through this thing where I hate this guy and I just want to kill him. But at the same time other things are happening. Other things are going on. And one of my old mates from Psychic Questing Days, Alex Langstone, he was still about and he was going into some interesting visionary states. He was interested in Reiki, he was interested in Osho, he hadn't quite got there yet, but he was very sensitive to what was going on with me. And we met up around his place and it was like, Donna was out of commission, we didn't know what happened to her, she didn't want to speak to us. After New Year's Eve, that was just all too much. But he sees this image of this Middle Eastern priestess woman dancing about on Silver Hill. And he gets a name from her, that her name is Selenka Astarte. And what kicks off is this whole visionary past life saga that seems to suggest that a bunch of Phoenicians who were me and Alex and Donna in a past life. This is a long story that I'm only going to give a tiny little details of. I have written about this on my blog in some detail before. I've let them know the whole story before. I've come over to Britain and been around in Kent on the Isle of Thanet, that there'd been a bunch of sacrificial stuff going on, and there was some weird karma left behind that we needed to sort out. And this story, each week that went by in January and early February 1993, we were getting more and more of this stuff. And I'm giving myself Reiki each night, and I'm reading Osho, but I'm also reading a whole bunch of stuff about Alice Crowley, and I'm just wanting to kill this geezer. Alex has a really strange experience where he goes on the astral to Donna's flat. And she's sitting there, and there's this huge, great serpent wound round her. We already had a whole thing about giant serpent in the Thames estuary and all kinds of things like that. And he has to get this serpent off her and kind of like throw it out the window into hyperspace and help her. And he later told me that whatever the hell this was all about, what can you say it was really all about? He was literally thought that he might die while this was going on. It was so intense and so powerful, it was unbelievable. And we'd identified a date that was the date when all this had to be sorted out by. It was February the 21st, which in a book, A Feast Date to the Goddess by Olivia Robertson, we saw was the feast date of a Phoenician goddess called Atargatis, who is often shown as a mermaid. And in the week running up to it, suddenly I get a phone call and it's Donna, and she's saying, I've been getting all this stuff about mermaids, I've been getting all this stuff about underwater, I think there's a place somewhere beyond Glastonbury, and we've got to all go out there next weekend. And you know, she didn't know enough about any of this. And she, the place she identified was quite obviously brain down, and it was like brain down, which is something you know, is the place that the unfortunate sea priestess and the Lord is sighted. And it looked like, you know, we now got some our own version, our own weird variant of that story. So we all met up, and of course, you know, the acid test of this. Is like, what's all this business with Alex pulling this bloody great serpent off her? You know, what was happening to her on the same night? Now, I knew what night that was. I knew what movie had been on TV that night. I knew she probably would have seen it. She remembered it. And she knew really quite well what happened that night. This guy, the guy that come back in, who was the right case, she woke up in the morning and he's like just sitting on the end of the bed. And he says, what a night I've had. I've just been pulling all these snakes off you and chucking them through the window. So, you know, that was enough for us to know that something pretty serious and strange was going on, and that we had to go on with it. While all this was going on, a mate of mine had videoed the whole of the series Twin Peaks when it first was on TV in 1991. Now, I hadn't seen it, and like it, everybody had been raving about it. 3 or 4 weeks in, I hadn't watched any of them. I thought, I can't just get into this thing, you know, this late. On one day, I'll see it on video. So this mate of mine had videoed the whole lot of them. And I decided to watch them all. Yeah, 28, 29 episodes in less than a fortnight. So while all this intensity is going on, we've got David Lynch Go-Go coming out of my TV set. And there comes a point where there's an area in the last few episodes of Twin Peaks called Glastonbury Grove that is the centre of either the Black Lodge or the White Lodge. You walk in there, and depending on your intent, you know, you either end up in the Black Lodge or the White Lodge. And there's this mysterious killer called Bob, who comes out collecting souls, and he possesses people and then murder people. And there's a scene, there's a cave, the Owl Cave. And I was watching this, and basically you get this scene where there's this cave, and then suddenly all these owls start flying out of this cave. And at this point, literally while this is happening, I'm hearing this tremendous banging and crashing from downstairs, and all this shouting and screaming. And something is going on, and what's basically happened is that the guy, my old mate, who's playing the bass guitar, has been, a bunch of guys have turned up and dragged him out on the street and taken him out there and beating him up in the road, and you're hearing all this classic dialogue like, oi, I said oi, all right. Smash, crash, bash, scream. Down there, while all the owls are flying out of the TV in my darkened room. And I'm thinking, okay, you know, this draws my attention to, again, this strange confluence. And as I was watching this, you know, I realised something very, very spooky. And there is a lot about this in Avalonian Eel, actually, that in Glastonbury in 1990, a self-professed black magician who had stated quite clearly that he was going to kill people in an astrologically determined sequence because he was collecting their souls, had actually murdered somebody in part wood, sent to the Glastonbury Zodiac. And one of the crazy things about the psychic quest in the era, we came back, we were in Glastonbury for a strange episode where we thought we were looking for some bad guys doing some nasties, and we were going to camp out at Dunder Beacon that night. And when we came down, we hear that this guy had been arrested, but he escaped from the police wagon, and he was on the loose. And he was on the loose while we were camping out in the middle of nowhere, and a whole preposterous situation occurred with us creating this armed camp to protect ourselves from this murderer. But anyway, the thing is, it was the mystery of, what is this strange confluence? It's actually Glastonbury Grove in Twin Peaks, where this guy who is a murderer who comes out to collect souls and then disappears back into the void, and part with the centre of the Glastonbury Zodiac, very much the place of light and dark, and there's an actual self-professed murderer who goes out collecting souls. Twin Peaks screamed after this murder, and the guy responsible for all those occult deals is not David Lynch, but a guy called Mark Frost, who's written some occult novels of his own. I don't believe that he knew anything about this murder. It just left a sense of something very strange hanging in the airwaves. So all of this is going on while we're building up to this Agaris thing, but at least I've got rid of this gear and plays the guitar downstairs. But no, it's not as simple as that, because his ex-missus now launches into full volume, wall-shaking playings of Whitney Houston's I Will Always Love You at any hour of the day or night. And in fact, from this point on, you know, things get really, really crazy with what's going on downstairs. She's left on her own. It's obvious to me, I can tell she's dealing speed. You know, she's taking the range. They're buying amphetamines off her. And one of the things I know from when I used to do amphetamines, you get very repetitive. And unfortunately, the thing about repetition with her was it was the base of your album's greatest hits that was being repeated. And it was being repeated like six times on the trot at volume that literally made my floorboards rise up and down. It made the grill on my electric fire start vibrating. And something that's got really, really macabre and really, really shitty is that there was an occasion when my mother rang up and she was telling me that my dad was really ill and she didn't know what to do. And he was in the bedroom and there was something wrong with his stomach and he was like screaming. And it's like, I knew where the phone was in the house, and I knew that if I could hear him screaming, then there was something badly wrong. And it's like, well, why are you calling me? Call an ambulance. But I've got my hand like this to hear her on the phone, because shang-a-lang, thump, thump, thump through the floorboards while I'm having this incredibly intense, dramatic, you know, emotional interaction with my parents. And so it went on. There were loads of times I just told her, you know, that she really did need to shut up, and she would do. And sometimes I had an Osho Tentacles war with her because I had real serious speakers myself. So if the Bay City Rollers went on, I just turned my speakers down, literally picked them up, put them on the floor, and put an Osho Tentacles album on at full volume. And so the afternoon just sort of went away. As 1993 goes on, the next stage from all of this is going to be, am I going to do Reiki 2? Reiki 2, these days, you can do Reiki 1, Reiki 2, Reiki 3, do the old lot of it in a weekend. It was a lot different then. It cost a lot more money for a start off, but also the sense that you had to wait a long time. There was an awful lot of vibe about doing Reiki 2 in those days. And I finally signed up to do it in October 1993. The way it was scheduled was two nights basically involved in that. And on the first day, you get shown the famous Reiki symbols, and then you take them away and you kind of internalise them and you learn how to draw them. And there's an attunement each day. On the morning that I'm due to wake up for the first part of the initiation, before I've even woken up, I've had this dream, and I'm in a room, and it's like some kind of, I don't know, New Age gathering or whatever, some sort of workshop, and suddenly this enormous great door, this doorway just appears in the middle of the room, and it's like there's this, I don't know, Native American shaman figure, something like that, standing there in all this light, and he points at me and he says, what are you prepared to sacrifice? And then I wake up and it's like, what? First, you know, I'm just about to go off and do this initiation. What are you prepared to sacrifice? That's sort of really revving it up a little bit, isn't it? So I thought, okay, you know, I'm open to this. What is going on? So we have the first day, we have the attunement, we get the symbols, and then I go into my dreams for the next night. And I dreamt that I'm back in my university hall of residence. And I'm in the bar, and it's kind of dimly lit, and there's a guy sitting in the corner, and he says to me, do you want to buy some dope? And I say to him, I don't do drugs anymore. At that moment, I woke up. And there were two things there. I realised the person that I was speaking to, sitting in the corner, offering me dope, was actually me from 10 years previously, because that's what I used to do. I used to sell dope at university. And I obviously realised, as I said, I don't do drugs anymore. That was what I was prepared to sacrifice. Now, at that time, I was 34 years old. I'd started smoking dope when I was 17, which is quite late by these standards of today. But what that meant was I was already aware of this, that I'd been smoking dope for half my entire life at that point. And I already felt, you know, it's not like I was doing it every day. It might be like once every 6 months I'd have a week where I'd get through a quart of dope or something at Christmas time or around the summer solstice, but I was still doing it. And I felt that there were opportunities, spiritual opportunities, if you like, things that were being offered to me through what was going on with Reiki and the sannyas energy that would be compromised if I just carried on. And I had thought to myself, I think I will stop at some point fairly soon. But that was so clear, so obvious, such an obvious message from higher self-central that you simply can't ignore something like that when it happens to you. I say that, I didn't ignore it. I have not ignored it. You know, that was the last spliff I smoked was September 1993. But I've met people that have actually had stuff that clear come to them. People that have had dreams that are that bleeding obvious, that are telling them something so clearly from the part of their consciousness that surely they want to give over to, and yet they have still ignored it. And I am very, very thankful that I didn't, and that I acted upon that. Reiki 2, you know, Reiki 2 for me, I've talked to people who've done Reiki 2, and I've said to them, well, what do you reckon? I said, oh, it's all right, yeah, it's all right. It absolutely blew my flipping head off for months and months and months. You know, I can't even go into the past life saga that opened up for all this, but my sense of past lives, which has now not been strong, something strange happened. There was an old friend of mine from university, he was at my flat in Southend, and we were talking, and he said that my face transfigured into something that looked like somebody out of the Renaissance. And there was a name that he gave me. I'm not going to say who it was. It's somebody that's reasonably famous in magical history. But it was like, maybe that was a past life of yours. And it was like something was just set in motion. If you believe, if you go along with this, you don't have to be absolute about it, but if you go along with this, some part of your brain is going to be activated, that this is the only way to activate it through this, whatever it is, this emotional mythology of past lives. But I got an immense amount of astonishing stuff started happening from that point on. And the climax of it, I'm jumping ahead a bit here, but the climax of it was, as part of this whole business with my nan and the dolphins and the ETs and all this malarkey, he was quite into numerology, and I always thought, numerology, unless it's the sacred gematria of the Hebrew and the Greek alphabets, it always just struck me as a right load of old bollocks, and I'd never paid any attention to it. But he kept going on about stuff and the number 33 and blah, blah, blah. And I worked out that there was a way of seeing that my birthday added up to 33. And that because we were still in the 1990s, there were dates that I could make by the same estimation add up to 33. And I started playing the game that if I had to do something in Poland and I knew there was a 33 day, say in 2 days' time, I'd wait until the 33 day. And I had this sense of some kind of multi-dimensional grid that was like a higher geometrical form of my true identity, and that the more I gave over to that, the more symmetrical the things that came back at me would be. You know, I've talked to this group about synchronicity before. This was an example of how I tried to play games a bit. And working as I did in the civil service in Southend, there was an option to take what they called flexible early severance, which was like redundancy pay. And that would give me enough money to leave Southend and come to Glastonbury. And I thought, I'm going to do this. So filling in the forms and handing it over, I chose a 33 day to do it. Now once you've done that, what comes back at you is out of your control, out of your control entirely. But the letter that came back to me, telling me that I'd got it, telling me that I was accepted, and thereby keying in the process whereby I left Southend and came here, arrived in my inbox on the 500th anniversary of the death of the character that I had been set off on this journey with when my friend had seen my face transfer into it. So there was a very, very strange usefulness in all of this. But during this period of time, you know, it got the period of time whereby I've left the drugs behind, I want to move to Glastonbury, but it hasn't all been fully set up. Things start to get very, very intense. Remember, I talked to you about this woman, Sandra, that had turned up, who was a bit of a weird one, and we kept her at arm's length. Well, in the early part of 1994, she ended up splattered all over the front pages of loads of the tabloids because she had wanted to marry the Yorkshire Ripper. She had been writing to the Yorkshire Ripper every single day for a year, letters, some of which were like 20 pages long. They had allowed her to speak to him for 10 minutes a week on the phone. And the stories, you know, started to come into our local newspapers. She had had breast enlargements, and the headline in the local paper was, "I want bigger boobs for my darling Ripper." Now, we are a long way into, you can't make this shit up now, this is serious stuff. And what I found was, from that point on, for a couple of years actually, whenever things were about to get really seriously weird and you needed a kind of warning signal, this woman would surface. She would appear on the radar in some absolutely bonkers scenario. You know, you'd be channel surfing and you'd end up on Channel 4 on, you know, nearly midnight on a Friday night, and there she'd be, you know, in silver hot pants, disco dancing on some boat or something. The hell. But she ends up, you know, she has a career as a porn star, specialising in large insertions, yikes. But her greatest achievement, in my opinion, was one Easter when she hired out an art gallery in London and put herself as a living art installation where she was like crucified naked while a tape recording of her hypnotic regression that she'd done going over sexual abuse that she'd had as a child was played. Yeah, last time I checked in with her, I think she was a hip-hop poet. She wrote a 300-page book about all this shit in 2006. You know, I obviously don't even want to look at one page of it. But the minute, you know, this kind of kicked off, things, you know, became more and more intense. Now, one of the things that you always hear about with Kundalini is it stirs the old sexual energies up. Now, one of my memories when I was at university, and I write about this in Avalone Neil, when I first got there, there was a girl in the same hall of residence as me who soon got a reputation as a nymphomaniac. So, as a young guy, you know, I felt obliged to sort of check out and see whether this was true or not. And I got quite matey with this girl. And the thing that fascinated me about her was that just before she came to university, in the summer, leading into going to university, she had had a situation where she and the people around her believed that she was possessed by the spirits of Hitler, Nero, and Sid Vicious. And they had actually got a bleeding Catholic priest in to do the full bellbottom candle number on her. And, you know, me, young guy that I am, I'm wondering, what is it going to be like to have sex with somebody who's been possessed by Hitler? This is where you're at when you're a young guy. So there's one particular memory that I've got on this occasion. And we'd been to some party, and she stayed over in my room. And at that point, I used to have a poster on my room by H.L. Geiger, who did Alien. He did a version of Baphomet, who's like the devil on the tarot card. This was a poster on my wall. And I woke up on a Sunday morning, the guy that was in the room next to me was like Christian Union, and he had like his church service on. And the guy in the room opposite me, he was a vicar's son, and his thing was like he used to go around churches with hand bells, you know, and he also, him and his mates would do church crawls rather than pub crawls. They'd go from church to church, they'd bring the bells. And he invited me into his room one day, and he had this LP of famous pop tunes played on hand bells, and you know, Yellow Submarine, all this sort of stuff. So these are the people that I've got around me, and I'm waking up, you know, Sunday morning, I can hear the church service. There's this extraordinary woman asleep next to me, and there's this picture of Baphomet on the wall, and I think to myself, Paul, what the doing, man, who are you? What is going on here? And I always remembered that, and I keep diaries, I keep one line diaries, and I knew when that was. And this girl actually contacted me on that exact anniversary towards the end of 1993. She didn't know that, she had no association of that whatsoever. But the symmetry of it, you know, she was up in London, I was in Southend, so we met up. In March we met up, and it was extraordinary to see her again. I'd seen her for like 12 years at that point. And it was quite a racy conversation, because she was a bit of a wild woman. She told me a few interesting tales about some of the little adventures she got up to. Now, I got back to Southend that day, and I'm just sort of about to get the evening meal together, and I think, I want to have sex with a prostitute. So I got me dinner together. I want to have sex with a prostitute. Yeah, really? What, you want to do that? And I'm kind of almost starting to twitch, you know. It's kind of like there's this weird, dark, obsessive kind of thing coming out. About an hour goes by, and it's like I'm just repeating this in my head. So, well, okay, look, let's do some tarot cards. Cut the tarot cards. Is that what I'm supposed to do? And at that point, I had the Herman Heindel deck, which some of you might know. And there's a version of the Empress card. It's very, very interesting. It's got a kind of sort of Botticelli Venus figure standing on a crescent moon on the sea. And behind it is this open doorway, which represents the letter Daleth, the Hebrew letter Daleth, which is this open doorway, which is kind of, if you look at it the way it falls on the Kabbalah in the Golden Dawn Crowley attributions, it's like the crossing of the abyss through to the supernal light. And I just, one card, am I supposed to do this? Shh, Empress. No, really, am I supposed to do this? Empress. Am I supposed to do this? Empress. And I think half a dozen times. So like, it's Southend, you know, you've got your local paper, died of prostitute, you know, somebody's going to come round you about half an hour's time. Who the hell's it going to be? What's going to happen? You know, a lot of people tried to interest me in chaos magic during that period of time. And I just, you know, I read Pete Carroll's books and I listened to a few tapes. It was like, I know this. I've got my own version of this, man. I don't even need to pay attention. You want chaos, then spend a bit of time with me, mate. So I made this call, and it's like some woman that I've never seen before in the whole of my life is about to ring my doorbell, and within 5 or 10 minutes, I'm going to be having sex with her. What the fuck? Now, at that point, I'd got in my hallway. I'd taken the major arcana trumps of the Crowley Thoth deck, and I'd blown them up to A4, and I'd got all 22 of them in this stonking great gallery along the whole hallway. And it really helped me to internalise the attributions and to learn the Kabbalah of it. And, you know, back in the days when I was smoking, I would just spend about a whole hour just slowly walking along, staring at these cards till they went three-dimensional. It was flipping awesome. So the doorbell rings. This woman comes in, oh, Crowley Thoth deck. Yeah, I prefer the Golden Dawn myself. And she starts talking to me, oh yeah, I was with one of my friends earlier on the day. She's just got out of prison. She shared a cell with Myra Hindley. And it's like, so that's the beginning. That's the beginning of a really strange period of time in my life that went on over a year And by the time it was all over, I had probably spent about £2,000, right, or more and more episodes like that. That were, I won't even go into all the details. That, if I ever write this up as a book, I will do, but you get the general idea. And as this starts to happen, so everything becomes more and more unglued. I'm working, you know, I've been working for a while in the VAT office at Southend. So like Normsville, right? Total freaking Normsville, or not actually, as the case may be. It's a 15-story building. There are 1,000 people working in it. Now we're all sitting around tables, you know, maybe four or five of us at a table, you know, and there's a space, you know, a guy is transferred, there's a space next to me, and this young lad is put there. And he's on a kind of a gap year of a difference, you know. He's been to college, he's going to go to university, he's going to have a bit of work experience working with us. So he's sitting next to me. And the way it was in there, you're on flexi times, so people coming and going at all different times. And he's only been there a couple of days, it's half past four, me and him are the only ones there. So he starts talking to me, and he decides to open up with me that, in fact, you know, his dad had been on the front page of Sun for being the Southend werewolf. His dad had turned up in a car with a prostitute and parked himself up in the police station and gone in there and said, for God's sake, arrest me, lock me up. It's a full moon, I'm about to turn into a werewolf. Or, you know, once a story like that gets out, it's on the front page of Sun. Of course it is. So I heard all about this, you know, and it became quite remember, there's 1,000 people working there, it's a 15-story building, and all the people to put in next to me. And he would come in and in the morning and say to me, oh, we had the exorcist in last night, and I'd say, well, was it business or was it a social? We used to have a bit of a laugh about it. And everybody else, well, you know, they couldn't handle it. So that's, you know, that's quite amusing. But it started to get a lot less amusing. You know, there was a woman that worked, she probably worked about as far away from me as that wall is there in another section, but that near to me. And she was having a baby, that the whole baby shower thing. You know, it's a nice wholesome thing, off she goes. But unfortunately the whole postnatal thing kicks in. And husband comes home in the lunch break, he works in the same place, and she's kind of dancing about in the living room, and she's sitting like a failure, you know, and she's singing this little song about, you don't have to worry anymore because the baby is dead. And he realises that the window is open, and yet she has thrown the baby out of the window, and he's dead. So this is a terrible, terrible, terrible thing, and it obviously absolutely mashes everybody that works in that department, and people have real trouble dealing with it, of course they do. And people debate, you know, the whole issue of when a good person does bad things, but they're still a good person, or what the hell, and there were some people that were not prepared to forgive. There was another guy who worked on the same floor, and he had been part of the Andy Collins groups. He had been part of psychic, a little bit part of psychic questing, and he'd been talking about getting into Carly. And people that were around him started to sense a little bit of a vibe building up around him. There was a guy that went on a camping holiday with me, he said something really strange happened. They were walking through this path in the woods and they found like a dead cow with like, that was, it's obviously been dead for ages, with like, you know, its guts off, ripped out or whatever, and it was like, how often do you see that? You know, why the hell did the farmer or whatever not, you know, and it was like people thought, I don't know about this, and people started backing away from it. I mean, this is 20 years ago, and I have to say with some of these stories that I really hope that I'm not distorting any of these details, and that if anybody ever sees this and was any way part of it, and I have got something a little bit wrong there, you know, my profound apologies for that. But what followed he's basically, as I tell it, as far as I know, he got a weird relationship with his sister. You know, she'd even come home one day and she'd sold his record collection, this sort of thing. But he was all right with her, and he went round to her and her boyfriend's flat. They were in a multi-story block of flats, couple of floors up. He goes round there and they do some mushrooms. And something goes badly wrong. The boyfriend, basically, I don't know if it's a big knife or it's a machete, but he hacks the sister to death. They're all on shrooms, he hacks her to death. And he commits harakiri. He goes up to the window, puts the knife, puts the blade through him, and goes out the freaking window. Amazingly enough, he didn't die. But here is this guy tripping his brains out in this room with his sister, hacked to death in there. Now, I've always, you know, for a long time, on the basis of Captain James T. Kirk in Star Trek Tender Wrath of Khan, I've always believed there is no such thing as a no-win situation, that you can change the rules of the game. But in that situation, fuck that. That is a no-win situation. I don't know the subsequent history. You know, I know that he survived, he didn't kill himself, but that is absolutely freaking terrible. So now I'm sort of in this office and I'm starting to think, what's going on? You know, these things are coming closer and closer and closer to me. You know, I've got Sandra and the Yorkshire Ripper. You know, I've got a prostitute turning up talking to me about Myra Hindley. I've got people throwing their babies out the window. I've got this Carly machete murder. I started to think of the Aghoris, the tantrics in India, and the rites that they do, you know, in the cremation grounds, and some of this stuff that you see also in Tibetan Buddhism, where basically you are sitting in the middle of this scenario and a whole drama of consciousness is being played out around you. And, you know, the blood drinking, skull smashing Dakinis turn up, and they work such a profound number on your emotions. And stuff that you may never ever get a handle on, other than just somehow you have got boogie with it. And my understanding, you know, from all the books I've read about all the gurus and so on, and the way this force works, especially the way Reiki works, is that it's ultimately a benevolent, compassionate force, and it will never give you more than you can handle. And yet there's no question about the fact that there are case studies of, you know, people that haven't handled it. There are casualties, there are people that go off the rails, there are people that flipping go bonkers and die as a result of all of this. And I had to bear it in mind. It was like, how much weirder is this shit going to get? Now, one of the other gurus that was on the case was Sai Baba. Now, Sai Baba, a very controversial figure now. A lot of people think he's a fake. A lot of people think he's just a pedo, or that he's somebody that does a whole bunch of conjuring tricks that David Blaine could manage. I, however, had an awful lot of experiences that suggested to me that, you know, something really extraordinary was going on, that there was blessing power there. And I'd been involved, you know, we've got all this going on in our building, in the VAT HQ. One of the Indian ladies that worked there was the leader of a local Sai Baba group. And they used to get together on his birthday, hire a school out, and have a whole day of programs. And me and my friends got involved in chanting Hindu stuff to a whole audience of 500 Hindus. And there's some stuff in Avalonian Eel that will tell you how weird that got. And I was told a woman, I knew her from the Sai Baba gatherings, not very well, but I knew her. She was working on the floor underneath. And a mate of mine who knew about her said, look, she's going out to India, and she's saying if you want to write letters to Sai Baba, she'll get the letters to him. Now, there's a whole thing amongst Sai Baba devotees that getting him a letter is a really big deal. That all he's got to do is just touch the letter, and whatever it's all about, you know, something is going to happen. So it's sorted. If you've got a problem, it's sorted. if something needs to be set in motion, oh, he doesn't even have to read it, he just touches it. So I said, yeah, okay, brilliant. I'll get a letter to Sai Baba. I wrote a letter to Sai Baba and it was given to this woman. Now, how come she was going out to India at this point? She was seeking to escape an absolute epic shitstorm that had gathered about her as a result of things that had happened the previous year. She had been talking to her mates about how, you know, she lamented the lack of a boyfriend, and then she met this guy who was incredible, he was a great lover and all the rest of it. She was telling all her mates about it, but he would go missing. You know, there were occasions when he just disappeared for a few days. Where's he gone? What's he doing? The obvious thought is he's got another, you know, he's got other women on the go. In fact, this was a chap called Colin Ireland, and what he was doing was going up to London and killing a total of 5 gay men during the summer of 1993. I don't even want to go into the details of how hideous some of this shit was. He was completely and utterly freaking insane by any working definition of it. And it's interesting that our mate Sandra claims that, you know, she made a few noises to suggest that she had known him during this period of time as well. She was fascinated by serial killers. So this girl ends up on the front page of the Sun. I had sex with a serial killer. And so it was that I get a letter put into the hands of Sai Baba by a woman who's been on the front page of the Sun for having sex with a serial killer. So I guess the story is, what the hell was in that letter, man? And like, did anything come of it? As you know, I was trying to move to Glastonbury, so I put in this letter, you know, Sai Baba, I really want to move to Glastonbury, I'm hoping that your blessings can be with this whole process. And there's also a thing going on in the Reiki world, you know, there's these symbols associated with Reiki. There was another woman, a woman called Kathleen Milner, I think her name was, and she'd come up with these other symbols, and she was saying she'd been given them by Sai Baba, and I'd been attuned to these symbols, and it was quite a vibey attunement, but everything I knew about Sai Baba, I didn't believe that this was the truth. I didn't think this was his style at all. I didn't think these symbols would come from him. And I was quite concerned about it at the time. And I actually put in this letter, I would really like to have this cleared up, you know, as it's come from you, hasn't it? So this letter's got to him, I think it was the end of 1994, and the way it worked out was, I actually came here at the beginning of June 95, and it's a Saturday morning, and I'm all set to move. I've got everything packed up, and a mate of mine is going to come round in a van. But there's some problems with the van, and there's some problems with the traffic, and he's delayed by more than an hour. And what that means, now I'm literally just sitting in the living room full of boxes, all packed up, ready to go, is that the morning post comes, and if he'd been at the time originally arranged, I wouldn't have seen it. And what came through is just one item. It was a Reiki newsletter that somebody else had actually subscribed me to it. I didn't subscribe to it myself, by a guy called William Rand, who was quite interested in discovering the verifiable history of Reiki and all the rest of it. So I've got a few moments, so if I look at it, I open up the envelope and, like, you know, somewhere a couple of pages in, Sai Baba Reiki symbols. And there is a whole little article that there is somebody that has been able to actually get an official statement from Sai Baba's camp about these Reiki symbols, and he has said, no, they are nothing to do with me. So bearing in mind that I want his blessings on a trip to Glastonbury, bearing in mind that I want to hear for sure what the score is with these Reiki symbols, on the very, you know, on the very moment that I'm about to leave for Glastonbury, I get that. Now, I trust you agree that that's enough to be going on with, you know, as far as I was concerned. That was a result, but remember how that result had come. In all of that horror, there was something, you know, transformative. In all of that, there was something transformative. As a little bit of an amusing postscript, after I moved to Glastonbury, I discovered that a woman who lived next door to me, directly upstairs across from me, and I used to have some hi-fi wars with her as well. She was a daughter of a mate of mine. And they all came down to Glastonbury, and I gave her a Reiki 1 initiation. And we talked about that this loony woman downstairs who played the basic roles and all the rest of it. And I remember one particular night where she had just gone out and started this enormous great bonfire in the garden. It was like about 10 o'clock at night. She just kept like burning the furniture. And God knows what else she was doing. And my neighbour remembered this only too well. And it was really tragic because like even with the windows closed, the amount of smoke that got into their place, the budget of people died as a result of it. So they well remembered that. But they'd also talked to the old woman that lived downstairs and somebody that lived further next door to them. And it turned out that the flat that I used to live in had been a brothel once. And there'd actually been a fire there. And the whole thing had been gutted. So I don't know, man. But in more recent years, remember, I'd never physically been right in contact with Osho or Sai Baba or looked at Andrew. I hadn't even been, you know, they weren't even alive in some cases. But since coming to Glastonbury, whenever I'm able to, I will go and have darshan with Mother Mira. And just as a little postscript on the false and how it works and how tangible it is or it isn't, you know. I remember one occasion when I was in a queue of people shuffling along the floor to go up to Mother Mira. For those of you who don't know, she kind of touches you on the head and then you look up, she stares into your eyes. It's only a matter of seconds and then you move away and that's all it takes. I was in the queue, you know, shuffling along, and suddenly my right shoulder just cracked and sort of dropped into place. And I thought, oh, what's all that about? And as I got nearer, my feelings started vibrating, you know, they did. My feelings started vibrating. And there was another occasion where I'd been out to see her in Germany, and I'd had a few months where I had this weird eczema on my hands. Go up to her, she touches me on the head, she looks at me, next morning the eczema's gone, it never comes back again. Now, one way or another, however that works, that is a physiological, real thing. So, the way I've been set up, before I come to Glastonbury, amazing experience whereby I've given up drugs, you know, in this Reiki 2 initiation context. You know, I'm never going back to that, am I, after that, as if I could violate the integrity of that. I've been through this whole intense Hall of Babylon, serial killer, weird shit, which reaches this kind of climax when I get a letter actually put into the hands of Sai Baba by a woman that's been on the front page of Southend, sex with a serial killer. And in all of that is the very moment of my departure and a new life. Now, I'm not going to say everything is hunky-dory after that. I'm not going to say that like everything is just flicking cotton and candy floss and crystal unicorns from that point on. All kinds of stuff arises. All kinds of stuff is going on for me right now. But that particular, distinct scenario was absolutely and utterly extraordinary. And from time to time, I, you know, hear stories from people who I feel are going through what I take to be their own version of the same thing. So I offer that up to everybody here, I offer it and to anybody else that's going to end up seeing it out on the internet land. One day I'd like to think of a book about it, but I'm hoping that it has been of some use to you. Thank you for coming and listening.